This morning I mentioned Proverbs chapter 24. And we're going to take that verse tonight, verse 10, 11, and 12, as our key text. Then we're going to run over to Jude 23. Then we're going to go back over into Matthew chapter 7. Proverbs chapter 24, beginning in verse 10. I'm going to read the key text tonight in the NIV. I like the wording of it a little bit better. It's a little easier to understand. The other two will be in King James. If you falter in a time of trouble, how small is your strength? Rescue those being led away to death. Hold back those staggering toward slaughter. Wow, those are strong words, aren't they? If you say, but we knew nothing about this, does not he who weighs the heart perceive it? Does not he who guards your life know it? Will he not repay everyone according to what they have done? Father, we thank you for this opening text, that Lord God, that we can glean from it. Father, gleaning, as you know, means that we gain some sustenance, some food, something that will benefit us. So Lord God, we ask you to open our hearts, feed us, and Lord, help us to benefit from your word. Oh Lord God, help us to apply this word to our life tonight, that Lord God, we'll grow. Grow as individuals, grow as a church, Lord God, and Father, grow closer to you. Help us to be obedient with what we're about to learn. Open our hearts up to your Holy Spirit, that he may have his way with us tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Tonight I want to talk to you about some urgencies. Stir yourself a little bit. And be open to what God has. There in Proverbs, the 24th chapter, the 10th verse, it says, if you falter in the time of trouble, how small is your strength? In other words, when you start failing, when you're tested, when you're strength falters when you need your strength. How small is your strength? How many of you reaching out toward a loved one that was caught in a river current would be satisfied with a broken or faltering strength? Would it be acceptable for you to be weak when your loved ones are about to perish? It's too late when the time of trouble comes to find out if you're strong enough. It's too late to wonder if you're capable of hanging on with a grip strong enough to sustain. You need to be working on growing and building your strength before the strength is needed.
That's right.
I remember the days in the hospital when Shawnell had fallen and gone into a coma. She was on life support. I'd been by chapels in hospitals many times. I'd never gone into one. But during that time of trouble, let me tell you, when I pushed that door open into the chapel and went in by myself, how weak I seemed. Oh God, I don't know if I can kneel. Oh Lord God, I don't know if I can stand. And Father, I don't have words to cry out to you. how insignificant and weak I was to walk in that chapel with my daughter on life support and worrying how long I could stay in a chapel and pray. Am I strong enough? Have I walked with you long enough, Lord? I was an ordained minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'd been a youth evangelist. I'd seen many people come to the Lord up to that point. And as I pushed that door open to the chapel, all these thoughts rushed in. Oh Lord, am I strong enough? Are you operating in your strength or God's? His strength is made perfect in your weakness. He asks you to give it. If you think of it this way, maybe the Lord sitting there at times and saying, give me your weakness so that I can be your strength. It's kind of like your fish and loaves type thing. Lord, that's all I got is my weakness. And He'll take that weakness and He'll bless it. And look at what He can do with it. If He can take a few barley loaves and a couple of fish and feed 5,000 people, what can He do with your weakness if you give it to Him? Lord, that's all I got is weakness. Because let me tell you what. A few days after I walked in that chapel and I pushed that door open and all those thoughts about, Lord, I don't know if I can even pray. Lord, I don't know if I got strength in my legs to bend down and get on my knees. And then, Lord, oh my Lord, can I get up? And Father, can I spend any time, any meaningful time with You? A few days later, as I lifted that baby up out of her bed and held her in my lap after giving her to Valerie and telling her, Sissy, Daddy can't fix it, but I know a God who can. We talk a lot of times about how you want to see Jesus. So, Sissy, I'm sending you to see Jesus because He can fix it. And I grabbed that baby and brought her head up to my chest like we've done so many times. And three times through, while everything stopped, I sang the big song. That was what she and I called it. His Majesty. Worship His Majesty. King of Kings. Lord of the Tall, Almighty God. His strength was made perfect in my weakness. The big song. How did I go from not knowing whether I could get up from a prayer to the time that I could sing the big song three times while I sent her to see our Jesus? It was a few days of transformational power, of drawing close to God because nobody else could help. God can do miraculous things with a little bit of stuff you can give Him. Moses, what do you have in your hand? It's just a stick. Well, Moses had to have a little bit of God in his stick, didn't he? Yes. What a little bit of God in his stick. The seas parted and the water came from the rocks. Okay? And he led 2 million people out of bondage. Lord, what do you have? Lord asked him, what do you have? God, all I got is a stick. Lay it on the ground, Moses. Oh, my Lord, look at there. It's a snake. Pick it up by the tail, Moses. You could tell it wasn't me. I'm not so sure about picking up a snake that's not in a pen somewhere like that. If you falter in a time of trouble, how small is your strength? But how great can it be if you give it to God? Verse 11, it says, rescue those being led away to death. It says, rescue those. This is an old-fashioned message to you. Hadn't heard it in a long time about rescue the perishing. Rescue. Rescue them. It's a message of urgency tonight that's coming right out of the book of Proverbs. Rescue those that are being led away to what? Death. People are dying all around, and we're worried about whether or not that the air conditioner is set at the right temperature. We're worried about whether or not we're going to get out in time for our lunch on Sunday afternoons. We're worried about whether or not our clothes are right, or if we're sitting in the right spot, or somebody's got my place. But God's Word says, rescue those who are being led away to death. The enemy is out there seeking whom he may devour. He's sitting out there like a roaring lion trying to destroy people. And we're sitting there wondering whether or not our roast beef is going to be good enough when we get home. Rescue those mean led away to death. Maybe we need to return back in times when I was a young child at home, and I remember my mama getting some kind of steak. I don't know what it was. We normally raised our own beef cattle and so forth. But she had gone to the store and she had bought some steaks. Daddy, he was traveling all the time, and he came in on Friday nights. And she had this old cast iron broiling pan that she would stick in under the broiler, get that thing just scorching hot. She'd get these steaks, put a little bit of butter, some salt and pepper on top of them, stick them up in that broiler, slide it in there, and they'd cook on both sides just almost instantaneous. And she took those things in a platter, and you know the juice that comes out, that's the best stuff. She poured that all over the steaks, brought those things to the table. And my oldest brother, Tommy, he sat down and he chewed it. He sawed off a piece of that. And that's about the kindest way I could say he could have got that steak apart. But he took a knife and he sawed that thing. And he got a piece in there and he started biting it. He said, "Mama, this is tough." And she said, "It'd be tougher if we didn't have it." My mama was quick. Mm-hmm. She was sharper than any two-edged sword, I tell you. She was a good introduction to God's Word. You didn't complain much about Mama. She was glad we had steak. She was glad she was able to go to the store that day and be able to buy that steak and bring it home for her family. Like I said, I don't remember what it was, a little thin cut of steak and so forth. And it was chewy. Tasted good. We didn't eat steak a whole lot. It was a blessing. But as we get older, we start forgetting the blessings of God. It'd be tougher if we didn't have it. It'd be tougher if we didn't have God's presence. It'd be tougher if we didn't have His healing. It'd be tougher if we didn't answer our prayers. It'd be tougher if we couldn't feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. It'd be tougher if we didn't have a place to come and worship. It'd be tougher if we didn't have air conditioning. It'd be tougher if we didn't have any dinner at home waiting on us on Sunday afternoons. It'd be tougher if we didn't know where our meal tonight or tomorrow was going to come from. Oh, it could be tougher. We need to understand how God has blessed us so much. But verse 11 says, rescue those that are being led away to death. Where are these people that are not saved going? They're going to hell. They're going to death. And the Bible tells us that if we know about God, we need to be rescuing these people. They need to be rescued. How do we rescue them? We get out there and we talk to them about Jesus. We don't have to talk to them about a movie. We don't have to talk to them about a meal. We don't have to talk to them about a restaurant. We need to talk to them about Jesus. That's what's going to rescue them. That restaurant's not going to help them. That movie's not going to help them. The latest gossip in town ain't going to help them. What do they need? They need Jesus. Rescue those that are being led away unto death. Look at this next, the rest of this sentence. It says, hold back those staggering toward slaughter. They don't realize that what they're doing is heading to death. They don't know that's the way they're being led. But it says, hold back those staggering toward slaughter. I don't know if you've ever been to a cattle processing plant. But as they unload those cattle into a pen and then they bring them down a chute, there's a place where they bring down and there's a gate that comes down. And there's a clamp that comes on the side of those cattle and they pull the head up and everything and they slaughter that animal. The animal is alive, it's on its feet. They wrench that head up and that neck is stretched with the nose pointing up, all mechanical, and one of the sharpest knives I've ever seen in the world comes through and severs the arteries going down the neck. All while that animal is alive. That's slaughter. Mm-hmm. That's slaughter. What chance does that cow have of surviving? None. And the devil's running people down a chute. And he's grabbing them by the head and he's pulling them up and there's a blade that's going to come to kill them. They're going to a slaughter. They don't have a choice. They don't have a chance. They're not going to survive if we don't sit down and rescue them. If we don't tell them about a Jesus who loves them and has died for them and paid a price that they don't have to die. Not to be condemned, but that they might live. That they can get out of the line of the slaughter. That they can find their way to a God who loves them dearly, not a devil who hates them with every breath he breathes. The book of Proverbs is real clear with this. It says, hold back those that are staggering towards slaughter. Hold them back. And what do? Well, I go to church. I'm glad you go to church. I praise God for those that attend church on a regular basis. But God's Word also tells us to hold back those that are staggering towards slaughter. They're going to be slaughtered. One of the saddest stories I've ever seen was over in Irwinville, sitting and talking about it to a young mama in a pickup truck, two kids bouncing around in the back, two little boys. She claimed she was saved, but didn't know about her husband and her two boys. They didn't know Jesus, never heard the stories about Christ, never been in a Sunday school class. Oh, my Lord. Can you imagine the slaughter of that family one day if they don't hear about Jesus? They need to hear about Jesus. They need to know about Jesus. They need to know a God that loves them. Not trying to control them, but wants to bless them and give them good things. The Bible says that all good and perfect gift comes from our Father above.
That's right.
If all the good and perfect gifts come from Him, guess where all the junk comes from? The one that's trying to clamp their head and slaughter them. That's who's giving them those things. Verse 12, and if you say, but we knew nothing about this, does not he who weighs the heart perceive it? There's people that don't understand what they've committed to when they accepted Jesus Christ. When they accepted Jesus Christ, sometimes that's where it ends. Well, they got saved, that's all they got to do. What are they going to do the rest of their life? My goodness. Let's just go ahead and kill them, send them on to heaven. If there's not something about living for Christ, then why accept Him right now? Let's just wait. Let's just wait. Right after I came down here, some of y'all know I had to go up to a funeral with my nephew, got killed on a motorcycle up in Atlanta. A lady pulled over on him and ran over him, crushed him. Paramedics that got there, David was still alive. And as they were trying to tend to him, he was dying there on the asphalt. But he told the paramedics, he said, my name is David Freeman. I'm saved. I'm okay. And he breathed his last breath. He had the opportunity to at least talk to somebody before he breathed his last breath. Crushed. from that wreck. Comforting words for most of the family. His little wife hadn't been married very long. Had to bury her husband. My name is David Freeman. I'm a Christian. I'm okay. But how many people don't have the chance to even think about that before they breathe their last? They've been knocked unconscious, or the enemy has cut their throat so fast that they don't know they're going into eternity. Hold them back, the word says. Hold them back. Hold them back that they don't go to that slaughter. Hold them back. Talk to them about what they need to be doing. Talk to them about the love of God. Talk to them about a Savior who died for them, who gave His very life for them, that they might live. Teach them about the counterfeits that the enemy has out there. Teach them about the truth. If you say, well, we don't know anything about this, tonight you do. You're starting to understand that you, by receiving Christ, by following God, you have responsibilities within the household of faith to sit there and hold them back, to hold them back from them staggering into the slaughter. Nobody intends to get into a slaughter. Nobody wants to get in a situation where their neck's pulled up and they're slaughtered like that. Nobody does. Nobody with any sense would. This world wouldn't want to either. They're not seeking that kind of thing. They're looking for happiness. They're looking for some kind of peace and settlement in their life. They're looking for all the things that our God can give them through Jesus Christ and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
It's part of your responsibility. It's not just the preacher's responsibility to do it. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that's just the pastor's job. That's something fabricated in modern day churches. If we paying a holy man to come out and do that, and so let him do it. I ain't got to. God says in His Word, if you say, but we don't know anything about this, does not he who weighs the heart perceive it? Doesn't God understand? Yeah, as long as you haven't been taught, but after tonight, you can't sit down and say, I didn't know that. Here it is in God's Word. This proverb is not written just to preachers. It's written to all those that follow God. Who wrote Proverbs?
Solomon.
Solomon.
Solomon. And Solomon is known as the
wisest man that ever lived.
So it's in God's Word. It's written by the wisest man that has ever lived. God does weigh the heart when you don't know, and He's capable of making judgment. But once you know, you're responsible for it. Does not he who guard your life know it, the Bible says? Who guards your life? Who controls whether or not you live or die?
God.
Father. Doesn't he who guards your life know your heart? Will he not repay everyone according to what they have done? What they have done right, what they have done wrong? How many times have you been disobedient to His urging when He sits down and says, share the gospel to this person over here? Lift up the name of my son? And we said, well, we got a preacher across town that's never been over where I'm at right now, Lord, and he'll probably never pass this way, and this person you're talking about will never listen to that man. And we pay him to do that, so I'm going to let him do it. What kind of excuse is that in front of a majestic God that says, hold them back from the slaughter? Rescue those that are being led away to death. Hold back those staggering towards slaughter. If you refuse to share the gospel when you know there's a need for the gospel, that would be the same as denying God. Well, we got Easter coming up, and in studying and so forth, what's the difference between what Peter did denying the Lord three times or what Judas did, and we call it a betrayal? What's the difference between what Peter did and Judas? In reality, both were denials, weren't they? In reality, both were betrayals. Peter cussed and everything else, said, "No, I don't know this man." What was the difference? Peter went out weeping. Judas went out weeping. What was the difference between a Peter's denial and Judas's betrayal? There was a heart problem with one of them. One returned back and became obedient. The other hanged himself after he threw 30 pieces of silver back at the feet of the religious leaders. There's really no difference between what Peter did and Judas did that night. We call one a betrayal. We preach hard against that. And the other, denial. We preach forgiveness on that one. But they're really the same thing. Doesn't the Lord, who knows the heart, isn't he the one who's going to measure those things out? See? How is the Lord measuring out? How many times have you sat down with the knowledge that somebody needs Jesus, but you let the joke go, or you let the little activities go and go, "Well, I don't want them laughing at me. I don't want them thinking poorly of me." Isn't that a denial? What did Jesus say? "If you deny me in front of men, I'll deny you in front of who?"
Father.
My Father. I hope you're getting some things out of this message tonight. I hope we're able to tie some things. Look over in Jude 23. That little bitty book right in front of Revelation. Right in front of Revelation. Jude 23. There's only one chapter in it, so we're just calling out the verse. Chapter 1, verse 23, if you need that. Okay? And if you get that, this is Brad Waters and I, we're talking, and this is one of our most favorite verses, and after you read it, you'll probably understand it, because it takes an evangelist to like this. Let's go up to verse 22 and start there. "And if some have compassion, making a difference." It means you need to care for people to make a difference. "And if some have compassion, making a difference. And others, save with fear, pulling them out of the" what?
Fire.
Do you think there's a bunch of people fixing to fall into fire that he was talking about, reach over and pull them back from that literal fire right then? What fire do you think he's talking about here?
Hell.
Pulling them back. We're out of the fire. "Hating even the garments spotted by the flesh." My goodness, that's a strong statement there. We're supposed to be pulling people back out of the fire, rescuing them. I heard some statistics the other day that says if you take all the people, all the unsaved people in the world, you'd end up, and if they held hand to hand, you could circle the globe and it would grow 20 miles every day from the new birth, people being born on this world. There's enough unsaved people in this world that you could make a ring completely around the earth and it would grow 20 miles a day. If you took the Christian clergy, the preachers, and they could each save or lead someone to Christ 100 times a day, and nobody else was involved but the preachers, which is what a lot of churches are putting the weight on, and you had no more births in the world, It would take over 100 years to lead them to Christ. If every preacher led 100 people to Christ a day, just the people that are here right now, it would take over 100 years to lead them to Christ. But keep in mind, that line is growing 20 miles a day. The unsaved line of people is growing 20 miles a day. And so, and others saved with fear, Jude says, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by the flesh. And yet we sit there and listen to people talk about what you don't got to do for God, and you don't got to go to church, and you ain't got to do this, and you ain't got to do that. It's okay. You got saved. You joined the church. You got baptized, as I hear all the time. You've been baptized. You ain't got nothing else to do. If you haven't been saved, you're going to hell. I was talking to a young man the other day, and every time I talk to him, we talk, and I hear things like when he's talking, he says, "My Lord, my God, my Heavenly Father, oh my Savior, Jesus Christ." And I'm sitting there, I'm sharing with him, and I'm using some of the same words. I'm using some of the same things. I'm saying, "My Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I love Jesus Christ so much. Okay, my Father in heaven. He is so good. The Holy Spirit has comforted me," and so forth. And we're dropping out the terminology, our Heavenly Father. And people go, I know God. He's not our Heavenly Father. The world talks about God. He's not Jesus Christ. He's just Jesus. No, he's the Christ, the Son of the living God. Oh, the Spirit was so sweet. No, it's the Holy Spirit. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. They're God. We're removing the deity, even in our language, out in the community, because we don't want to offend somebody. No, he's my Heavenly Father. Now, everybody in this room, I hope and I pray you have good daddies. I hope and pray that you don't have a broken nose and a cracking jaw from your daddy. That you never got beat. That you didn't have bones broken because of your daddy. I did. See? He wasn't a very good example. He was a good deacon, and he was a good Sunday school teacher, and those types of things. And the church knew him as a good upright man. That's not what we knew at home. Praise God, I got a Heavenly Father that dearly loves me. And I'm glad I had men and women when I was a child that would teach me about a Heavenly Father. And I remember being 6 or 7 years old and being in a Sunday school class and listening to my teacher talk about our Heavenly Father. And I'm sitting there thinking, I hurt where my daddy hit me. And she's describing a Heavenly Father that loves me. And I was 6 or 7 years old, and what I was thinking had nothing to do about this Heavenly Father she was talking about. But they kept teaching. And they kept talking about my Heavenly Father and our Heavenly Father and how much He loves you. And for God so loved the world, your Heavenly Father loved you so much that He gave His Son, Jesus, that you don't have to die. By His stripes we are healed. That He didn't come into this world to condemn you and haul you off down the road. I won't tell you what they called it, because He didn't like it. As a little young boy, little red suitcase, sitting there being dumped off in the middle of an old country road, dirt everywhere, I didn't know even where I was, and watching that old blue Ford pickup truck drive off as my daddy dumped me out. I didn't even know which way to walk, because I was a mistake. My daddy didn't care for me. I would never pay him back. These are the things he said. I remember that old station wagon coming over the hill, though, when Mama come. That was a good-looking station wagon. But I can't tell you how much it hurt that my daddy dumped me out. All I knew was it was the same place that old mangy dogs got dumped out. I got the treatment of a mangy dog. But I got a heavenly Father that's prepared a place for me. That sent his Son to die for me, that cares for me, that would not raise his hand and come across my face for nothing but in love. Because somebody held me back so I wouldn't stagger into the slaughter. Then I could be rescued. Then I could be rescued and led away from that path of death. You see, it's a big problem. And I know that was 50-something years ago. But it's the same death today. It's the same slaughter today. Probably even more wicked than then. Turn in your Bibles to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14. God's the same yesterday, today, and
forever.
Forever. Does His Word ever change?
No.
It abides forever and ever. Heaven and earth may pass away, but my Word shall not
pass away,
right? Okay, so I say that because I don't want y'all thinking, well, that's back in Bible times now, preacher. Look at verse 13, verse 7. I mean, chapter 7. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to what?
Destruction.
That's the slaughter gate. That's the death gate. And many there be which go in thereat. We walk around and we go, well, pretty much everybody I know, preacher, saved. Matthew would debate you on that. Let's read that again. Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. And to make it clear, he goes on in verse 14, he says, because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few, how many?
Few.
And few there be that find it. I know we try to be sweet and we try to be kind and we go, well, preacher, now the Bible says don't judge. Not exactly. That's not exactly what the Bible tells you. It says judge not lest you be judged, for by the same measure that you judge, you will be judged. Okay? So be careful when you start judging. But the Bible does not say you can't judge somebody. You can't judge whether they're saved or not. You don't know whether their name's written down in the book of life. When they bow their head and they ask God to forgive them and Jesus come into their heart, the Bible instructs you to accept them as a brother or sister in Christ. Okay? So be careful on how you judge. But Matthew just described a highway to hell and a stairway to heaven. Might be the anticipated amount of travel down both of them. Broad and wide is the way that leadeth to what?
Destruction.
Slaughter. Death. But it says go in the narrow way. That doesn't mean we've got a bunch of rules and regulations we gotta follow. It describes the person we're to follow. Jesus said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. And so we have the freedom tonight to follow Jesus. Is that okay? Can we follow Jesus? We're not talking about a bunch of rules and regulations about what we're supposed to do. Ladies, I don't care how long your hair is. I don't care how much makeup you wear. I know there's some denominations get all hung up about all that. I don't care. Men, you want to show your elbows again? Go ahead. Larry got it going on tonight. Okay, there's some denominations you ain't supposed to show your elbows again. Now, that's getting too risque. No, follow Jesus. Follow Jesus. If you follow Jesus, you'll be okay. If you follow Jesus, you won't be running people off. They can't dress up to your standards. If you follow Jesus, you won't worry about dusty kids getting up on our cushions in our sanctuary and offending somebody because they're getting them dirty, preacher. Follow Jesus, you'll be okay. Their clothes will be okay. If it bothers you, do you know what the Bible tells you? You know what the Bible tells you? That if somebody's clothes offend you, you know what the Bible tells you? Go buy them some clothes. Right? That'd hush up a bunch of complaining right there, wouldn't it? Mm-hmm. If somebody else's clothes are offensive to you, you don't think they're a good enough standard, the Bible says you that are blessed and have all your needs met should go out and purchase what they need. Mm-hmm. Wow. That'll get us quiet, won't it? Mm-hmm. See? What's more important, a cushion that your backside you're sitting on tonight, or some little boy that got out away from mama after she done spit shined him trying to get him to go to church and she brought him in a little bit dirty and dusty? I'd rather have the kid.
Absolutely.
I could rip every one of these things up, go throw them in the dump tonight and trade them off for kids. That'd be all right. Now, I'm not saying abuse things, see? But we had a bunch of dirty, leggy little boys in here, and some complaining got around about it. And no, I didn't go talk to that mama. I didn't mention anything about getting them cleaned up better. The word got out to them, and they don't come. One person. I'd rather have the kids. I'd rather go and take a loan out over Colony Financial and have these things dry cleaned than lose that baby. I'll pay the bill. I'd rather have that child. Because that mama has gone to daddy, and daddy has gone through the family, and in a fit of anger has thrown out what this church thought about that child, and that child sitting there listening to that joke. And so what is their idea of church? That person that said that, they're not here tonight. They don't attend right now. I'd rather have that baby. They're going to a slaughter. Well, preacher, everybody's going to die one day, but the devil wants to slaughter them. The devil wants to pull their head up and take a knife and cut them open. He wants to murder them. He wants to destroy them before they can whisper the precious name of Jesus. There's an urgency tonight. You see, church, the preachers can't do it all. 100 years just to handle the ones we got on the earth right now. Can't do it. 100 a day. It takes a line that's getting 20 miles long every day just from population growth. My goodness. There's an urgency. And everyone that's born, if they don't accept Christ, will be in that line around the world, ever growing. Being led to be slaughtered. Slaughtered by a hateful devil. When Jesus is standing there to receive them. Not a church, not a religion, not a bunch of rules, but Jesus. Rules don't impress me. Jesus changed my life. tonight as we close. Is there anybody that needs time at the altar, time just to sit down and pray the Lord? The Lord will weigh your heart. He knows where your heart is. Maybe you haven't heard Proverbs 24 yet, but you have now. Maybe you've never gone over to Jude and read that 22nd, 23rd verse. Pull them out of the fire. There's an urgency in God's Word. Do you need some time? Do you need time at the altar? We have time. We'll be closing in just a few minutes. Is there any other needs, any other thing that needs to be done? I don't know about y'all, I enjoyed the message tonight. We got off into some things that are a little bit deeper, I know that. But it's good to know God's Word.
Amen.
It's good to know God's Word. I'm tired.